Okay. So, welcome all of you to What's Up Over Edmonton for July 2022. My name is Jeff Robertson, and I'm a member of the Edmonton Center of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. Always start with a picture of the Queen Elizabeth Planetarium, because when we originally thought this idea up, we were going to have these sessions live in the planetarium. We were thinking this up right as COVID was beginning, and the QEP is not yet open. We're not meeting in public for anything yet, but we hope to meet there in the fall sometimes. Call this What's Up Over Edmonton because our skies here at latitude 53 north are quite a bit different than what is presented in a lot of popular astronomy publications and also talked about in the media. For example, this is the sky on July the 5th at 11 o'clock over Toronto. And I always like to point out the constellation Scorpius, or Scorpio, the Scorpion, one of the few zodiac constellations that actually looks like what it's supposed to be. In Toronto, or in that area, southern Ontario, you can see the entire constellation above the horizon. But in Edmonton, or really anywhere in Alberta, this is about as much as Scorpio as you're going to get to see. You're never going to see the tail and the stinger. You're just going to see the head and the bright star Antares, this guy right here. Most of the information I use comes out of the Observer's Handbook, which is put out by the RASC every year. It is 352 pages of just about anything the amateur astronomer would want to know. This year, there are six new content sections and three sections that had significant revisions. So what do we got in the sky in July? We got June showers because we had a lot of rain in June. In fact, we're supposed to get some here pretty quick, some more, which brings July mosquitoes. So what do we got? We've got all the planets are up in the morning. We've got a month more of perpetual twilight. And we've got the closest full moon of the year. And that occurs on the 13th. And I'm sure you're going to hear a lot of talk in the media about supermoons. And last month, I gave my thought of what I thought of the term supermoon. Sunrise on July the 1st is going to be at 5:09. Sunset will be at 10:06. There is no, in the astronomical sense of the word, night. On July 31st, the sun comes up at 5:48. It sets at 9:31. And we actually do have astronomical night, although not very long, from 1:14 in the morning to 2:06. So get out there when the sky is truly, truly dark. This is a planetarium portion, and as always, I have pre-recorded it, so I will start that now. We'll start the astronomy program with something a little bit different here. So I've set the time for 11 o'clock on July 1st. It's Canada Day, and where I usually am is standing above the ravine by the river valley, looking east toward the high level bridge. And if I looked up in the sky, I would probably see Vega up here, maybe Deneb, maybe Altair. But it is Canada Day, and it is 11 o'clock, so what's going on? Well, in Edmonton, we're having fireworks. Okay, enough of that, as Steve Martin might say, enough comedy jokes. So this is the night sky at 11:30 on July the 1st. We've got a three-day-old crescent moon about to set, and like the previous month, There are no planets to be seen in the evening sky. If we want to see planets, we have to go to the morning sky. In the morning sky is where all the planets are residing for the month of July. We have Saturn well up, Neptune, which is a telescopic or a good pair of binoculars, steadily held object, Jupiter, very obvious, very bright, then Mars, getting brighter every month. In binoculars, you can definitely see the orangey red color to Mars. Uranus, another binocular or telescopic object, and then bright Venus. Now this time here is 3:45 in the morning on July the 2nd. The planets, the naked eye planets, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, are all very obvious at this time. And there is Mercury, but it is past its greatest western elongation, and it is getting very, very low. If I just change the time here to 4:45, let's make it 4:30. You can see let's zoom right in here. It's very low, but it's a very, very tough target. I joined Alistair and two other members of our center on the morning of the 26th. And Mercury was almost impossible to see. It was, the sky was just that much, so bright that it was really tough to see. Alistair put a picture on our astro list, and if he didn't put an arrow there, you wouldn't even see it. It's a tough target, but the other planets, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn are all very obvious. And I must say, I am not a morning person, but I sure enjoyed getting up early on both the 25th and the 26th. 25th, we were hampered by a thick cloud preventing us from seeing, having any hope of seeing Mercury, but the other four were easily seen. Now, if we follow the planets through the month, you can see a few things going on. Of course, Saturn and Jupiter and getting higher and higher, and Venus is getting lower and lower at 3:45. Now, on the 15th, where we've stopped here, the Moon is south of Saturn, just below Saturn. And on the 17th, it's near Neptune. And on the 19th, it's past and just below Jupiter. And on the 21st, it's near Mars. Let's just zoom in here. Okay. So they're about two and a half degrees apart. And the next day, the Moon is near Uranus. And at 3:45, it's again about 2 degrees apart. But you could use the Moon to get, you know, with a pair of 10x50 binoculars, the kind I use normally, the Moon and Uranus on that day would be in the same field of view. As you can see, Venus is sinking. On the 26th, Venus is just below the Moon at 3:45. Let's maybe make this time a little, okay, just before 4 o'clock. Venus is a little bit higher, but it's down in the region of the sky where it's pretty mucky down there, Although Venus is fairly bright, even if the sky has a lot of muck in it, you may still be able to see it. Now Venus is going to ride pretty low in the sky, pretty much for the next several months. However, the sun is rising later and later, so you could, in the early morning hours, you could still be able to see it. Now, perpetual twilight ends on July 31st, but the time of true darkness only lasts in the early morning hours between 1 a.m. and 2 a.m. Now, at 4 a.m., where I've got the time set here, we are in the twilight. But it is a time you could, with a telescope, observe planets. Jupiter is always a very nice object to view in a telescope. You can certainly, even in a 60 millimeter refractor, you can make out the equatorial bands on Jupiter, and you'd be able to see the four Galilean moons, provided, of course, they're visible, they're not in front of or behind the planet. Here on the 31st at 4 o'clock, you can see all four in a line, starting with Callisto, Ganymede, Io, and Europa. And of course, Saturn is a great target. Now you're not going to see all these moons in a small telescope. A mid-size or large telescope will certainly show you Titan here, and you might make out Dion, but Rheanthesis, I'd be very surprised if you could see them. But Saturn, with its beautiful rings, is always a pleasant target. And next month in August, it'll reach opposition, which means we're going to finally have a planet in the evening sky to look at. Before we leave the morning sky and its parade of planets, there is a meteor shower in the early morning hours of the 30th of July, and it is the South Delta Aquariid meteor shower, named because it is in the southern part of the constellation Aquarius, near the star Delta Aquariid. It's a meteor shower that is best viewed really further south in the southern hemisphere, or down in the southern U.S. and such. Here we would expect somewhere between 10 and, on a good night, 20 meteors an hour, going all over the sky. One's going straight south. Probably wouldn't even catch them, because they would be moving so fast and have such a small part of the sky to see. But it is one of the showers we get as the Earth passes through the debris of a comet. The moon is full on the 13th of this month. It is a fairly late riser, rising at 10:49. This I've set it, this image here, for 11 o'clock. So as you can see, it is just coming over the horizon. Moonrise time is determined when the limb of the moon first comes up over the horizon, not when the moon is completely above the horizon. So as far as deep sky objects, there are some bright Messier objects you can see, and I've talked about these before, so I'm sorry if I'm repeating myself, but these are very nice objects to look at, and at this time of year, they're all conveniently placed fairly high up in the sky. And I've toggled my Messier objects here, so the first one we'll go to is the Great Globular Cluster in Hercules. Even in perpetual twilight, it is visible in a telescope. In a good pair of binoculars, you would see it as a fuzzy star, and it is you find the keystone of Hercules, the body of Hercules, and it is between these two bright stars that make up one corner of the keystone. And if you just follow a line with binoculars, you'll see it, and with a telescope, of course, with its narrow field of view, you have to be a little bit more accurate, but it is a nice object to see. There's also another globular cluster, M92. It's smaller, doesn't have any easy pointy references like M13 does, but if you draw a line between the top of the keystone and the end of its arms, Iota Hercules, it'll draw a line right through M92. And as you can see, the zenith straight overhead, so Hercules is fairly high up right now. And then of course there's the objects in the summer triangle, the ring nebula M57, constellation Lyra, and it is the remains of a sun-like star in its final death throes, and our star will eventually end up creating a planetary nebula like the Ring Nebula, but not for a long time yet, not for say 4 billion years or so. And there's another planetary nebula, slightly different shape, oops, the Dumbbell Nebula in Vulpicula, the Fox, and it is a planetary nebula. Again, it's the remains of a sun-like star. As sun-like stars die, they shed off their outer layers and create these beautiful nebulas. And we'll talk more about the summer triangle in August and September when the view is very good. But I will point out constellation Cygnus the Swan, or as the Cree call it, Niska the Goose, also known as the Northern Cross, and the head of the constellation is a double star, Albireo. And this doesn't show on this simulation, but it's a beautiful double star with a blue star and an orange star, and looks great in a telescope. It's also the Andromeda Galaxy, M31. In a pair of binoculars, even in the city, it'll look like a smudge in the sky. And I find the best way to find it is to locate the two legs coming off of Pegasus. And there's these two stars right here. And you just follow a line through the two stars and it'll lead you right to Andromeda. Another way to do it also is to locate Cassiopeia, the W, and you follow these two stars here in a line and then slightly below, and they'll point you to the Andromeda Galaxy also. And even in perpetual twilight, you'll be able to see it in binoculars or a small telescope. A small telescope is not going to show you the whole galaxy, though. It's just too big. The galaxy covers an area of sky a couple times the size of the full moon, so it's not going to fit. And before we close off this, I said there's no planets in the evening sky. Well, by the end of the month, hey, we've got Saturn. Has entered the evening sky by the end of the month. This is July 31st at 11 o'clock. And the sky is getting darker as we move toward the fall. So that's about it for the planetarium portion. And we'll carry on if you have any questions, and we'll carry on. Okay, are there any questions, or Alistair, do you have anything to add?
No, that was really good.
Oh, okay. Any other questions? If there's anything in the chat, I can't see it. It just popped up.
When you say a small telescope, what power are you talking about?
Well, power is determined by your eyepiece. When I say small telescope, I'm talking one that's like a 2 or a 3 inch objective.
Okay.
Okay. Telescopes aren't rated by power. We call small telescopes by the size of their mirror or their lens. So like a 2 inch or a 3 inch refractor, or a 6 inch reflector, or an 8 inch compound telescope, that sort of thing. So like when I was talking about a small telescope, for example, for Saturn, even a 60 millimeter refractor, which is your department store kind of telescope, you can see the ring of Saturn, even in that kind of a scope. You don't see a lot of definition in the ring. You're not going to see the Cassini division or anything like that, but you will see the ring. And again, with Jupiter, you'll see the band, at least two of the equatorial bands, and you will be able to see the little points of light for the Galilean moons.
And can I ask, for these images that you showed, do you have to go outside the city of Edmonton, or can you, go to a darker spot in the city and still see?
Planets you could see in the city. Some of the images I showed, it's best to go out of the city to a darker site. And also, what you see with your naked eye, like for the Ring Nebula, it's kind of colorful in that image. You're not going to see that because photographs pick up wavelengths of light our eyes can't see. The Ring Nebula to the naked eye is kind of a gray-white color. It's not going to have color in it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, anything else? And we'll carry on to the moon.
What do you see when you look at the moon? When it's full and round, do you see a balloon? Does it look like a cookie with the bite taken out? What do you see when you look at the moon?
Okay, in July, the first quarter is on July the 6th. The moon is full on the 13th, and as I mentioned in the planetarium portion, it is the closest full moon, so it's going to be a super moon or a super duper moon in the media of the year, and it's going to be 357,264,000 kilometers. 357,264 kilometers from Earth, so more super than normal. The July full moon is known as the buck moon because deer are starting to get their horns. It also goes by the name of the salmon moon, the raspberry moon, the thunder moon, the herb moon, or the hay moon. And there's other names in different cultures also, but these are some of the common ones I found, and they all relate to nature or agriculture. Certainly our little raspberry bush in our backyard is looking promising. Third quarter is on July the 20th, and the moon is new on the 28th. Oh, I always like to pick a feature on the moon. And I take it from Explore the Moon program, certificate program put out by the RASC. There's two of them, one for binoculars and one for telescopes. This one is from both. It's part of the binocular and the telescope program. And we're going to go to the Lunar Alps. And they are named after the Alps of Europe. There they are there. They form the northeast edge of Mare Imbrium, or the Sea of Rains, You can see it here. It's one of the larger basins on the moon. And it is also the south edge of Mare Fragilis, which is right here. And that is also, that is known as the Sea of Cold. So it, yes, they are the Lunar Alps, but there is bad skiing there. This is one of my pictures as the world's worst astrophotographer. However, I thought this one would serve its purpose. The Alps run about 280 kilometers between the crater Cassini down here and the crater Plato right here. So these are the Lunar Alps. Now the range is bisected by a great rift valley known as Valles Alpes or Alpus or the Alpine Valley. This valley connects Mare Imbrium here with Mare Fragilis, Sea of Cold, here, and it is about 150 kilometers long and 10 kilometers wide. And there's the Alpine Valley there. This is a better picture taken from orbit. The tallest mountain in the Lunar Alps is Mount Blanc, and it's right in here. And it stands 3,600 meters high, but most of the other mountains are 1,800 to 2,400 meters high. You can see there's quite a few peaks here. It's best seen around the first quarter moon or the last quarter moon because it's pretty much on the moon's longitudinal center line. So you want to catch it when the shadows are long and it really shows the detail in the Lunar Alps region. Now, the constellation I've picked for this month is a faint one. It's Vulpecula, and it's a faint constellation in the northern sky. And the name is Latin for the little fox. You're probably wondering, where is it? Well, here it is here. Doesn't look like a fox to me, but someone thought it did, and not only was it a fox, but it was a fox with a dead goose in its mouth. And they got that all out of this little right angle or hockey stick. The constellation contains 33 stars. It's a very faint constellation. There's no stars in that constellation that are brighter than fourth magnitude, and it is located in the middle of the summer triangle. The constellation doesn't really have any mythology behind it. It was introduced by an astronomer named Johannes Helvillus in 1687, and he said that Vulpecula, or the little fox with the goose, represented a fox carrying a goose to Cerberus, the dog that guarded the entrance to the underworld in Greek mythology. Helvillus had invented the Cerberus constellation also, but it is no longer in use. It does contain a couple interesting deep sky objects. M27, which is the Dumbbell Nebula. We talked about that just a little bit ago. And Brocky's Cluster, also known, there's a dumbbell there. Brocky's Cluster, also known more commonly as the coat hanger, because it actually looks like what it's supposed to be, unlike the fox here. The Dumbbell Nebula is a planetary nebula that remains, remains of a sun-like star at the end of its life. When stars like our sun reach the end of the life, and burn up all the hydrogen in the core, which is converted into helium. So, and the star begins to collapse and compresses the helium so much that it starts to fuse into other elements like oxygen, silicon, and such. And this extra energy expands and blows off the outer layers of the star, and you get this lovely nebula. And that's what our sun will do in 4 to 5 billion years. And this is just another picture. This one was actually taken by one of our members. Brocchi's cluster, the coat hanger. There it is there. Consists of 10 stars, magnitude 5 to 7. And they are, they're not all together. They range in distance from 238 to 2237 light years away. So it just happens to be, these stars happen to be lined up in to form a shape that is recognized as a coat hanger. And it is easily seen in binoculars. And if you have a camera with a telephoto lens and point it at the area of sky that it's in and take about a 15-second exposure at maybe ISO 800, it will record the coat hanger. And that's just another picture of it flipped the other way. Other highlights this month. Earth is at aphelion. That means the Earth is at the farthest it is away from the sun in its orbit. And that happens on July the 4th. We are still in noctilucent cloud season. We've had some very good displays so far. And I find July usually has the best displays. And we have all night International Space Station and passes and satellites too. And as I mentioned in the planetarium section, we have the South Delta Aquarian meteor shower on the early morning hours of July the 30th. So here we are. These are two pictures taken of the sun. With identical equipment, one at perihelion when it is closest to the Earth at 147 million kilometers. And that occurs around January 2nd, 3rd, or 4th. One of those dates is when we are closest to the sun. And then aphelion, when we are 152 million kilometers away from the sun. And that always occurs around July 2nd, 3rd, or 4th. And you can see there is a slight difference in size. Our orbit is pretty round. It is an elliptical orbit, as all the planets' orbits are. None of them has a perfectly round orbit. But the elliptical orbit isn't that stretched in either direction. We have noctilucent cloud season. These are the night shining clouds. These are particles very high up in the Earth's atmosphere, 60 to 80 kilometers up. Even though it's dark on the Earth, the sun below the horizon is shining on these and lights them up in a nice electric blue color. Some of the displays are very faint. Some of them are very bright and easily seen in a light polluted city. I took this picture standing in my street in front of my house, and there's a Misericordia Hospital. So I'm in the center of light pollution, and yet it still puts on a good display. And here's me standing out in the field looking at the noctilucent clouds just a few blocks from my house. And as I say, we've already had some very nice displays so far. This is a picture from a few years ago that Bruce McCurdy took over the downtown. And you can see the brilliant and beautiful noctilucent cloud patterns. And these are a couple pictures he took last week. This one a very faint display. You see it right there. You can always tell noctilucent clouds from just regular clouds, because the regular clouds look black or gray. The noctilucent clouds are lit up. And here's a nicer picture with nice ripples in the structure, and then our old-fashioned terrestrial clouds in front, these dark clusters. There's the bright star Capella. And noctilucent clouds appear on the northern horizon. In the northwest at sunset, and then moving across the sky over the night, and then the northeast closer to dawn. We've got ISS passes, good ones, throughout July. This is a chart taken from spotthespation.nasa.gov website, which only goes to July the 9th, but it gives you the times of the passes. As you can see, a lot of them are in the early morning hours. But some of them are fairly high up, 62 degrees high, 64 degrees high. That's very, very high. Because the ISS orbits at an inclination of 51.5 degrees, you'll never see it pass directly overhead. It's always going to be in the south part of the sky. And this is a chart from Heavens Above, which goes further into the month. And on the night of the 14th, for example, 13th and 14th, there's a pass just before 11 o'clock. Then there's another one at 12:30. Then there's another one at 2:06. Then there's another one at 3:42. So there are four ISS passes in a single night. And you can see that a couple of them are fairly high up. The 12:30 one is at 52 degrees. The one at 2:06 is at 59 degrees. So those are all very high up passes. And if we highlight, say, the 12:30 pass on the morning of the 14th, if you click on that day or that pass, you'll get a chart which will show you the path and the timing of the space station as it crosses the sky. And this one here is going to pass right through the summer triangle, just below Vulpecula, actually. And this is just a 15-second exposure I took from my backyard under a night with a full moon. That's the moon there, not a street light, of the ISS passing over the house. And also, there are satellites aplenty to be seen. And again, I've taken the night of the 14th with our 12:30 pass of the ISS. And these are all the satellites brighter than magnitude 3. So fairly bright, but you can see from midnight to 4:13 when the sky gets too bright to see any more satellites. So as you can see, there's quite a few of them. And this excludes the Starlink satellites, because if the Starlink satellites were included, I'd need two pages of this thing. And so I put a little movie together from my planetarium program just to show you the satellites. And of course, this is sped up quite a bit. So this is about a satellites going over Edmonton in a 2-hour period. So there's a lot. And as I mentioned before, we have the South Delta Aquariid meteor shower. The Earth is passing through the trail of Comet 96 Machholz, which is a 5.29-year period comet. This is the radiant here. And expect 10 to 20 meteors an hour. There is no moon. So if you're away from the city lights, dress warm and take bug spray, you will be able to see some meteors. So next month is Perseids, which is one of the more famous meteor showers, and with many more meteors than the South Delta Aquarius, and we'll talk about that next time. And there's a radiant there. So this is... Okay, so this is the space history section, something I've enjoyed doing, where I talk about some event that happened in the history of space exploration or astronomy or something that happened in a year that is divisible, that is a 5 or a 10 or a 50, a year that's divisible by 5, anniversary year. So this year it is a year that ends in 2 or 7. So after the twin Viking spacecraft arrived at Mars in 1976, NASA turned away from exploring Mars. And in fact, they didn't really do much exploring for quite a while. There was the Voyager probes that were launched in 1977. But with the exception of one craft, which was the Mars Observer in 1992, no American spacecraft attempted to reach Mars. And in the later part of the 1990s, then NASA Administrator Dan Golden pushed the space agency to think faster, better, and cheaper. So rather than trying to do everything on one particular mission like Voyager, was thought that many smaller missions would yield similar results over time at less cost. And an analogy might be sending several frigates to do a job rather than a single battleship. The Mars Observer in 1992 was an example of a battleship type of spacecraft, and it suffered a catastrophic failure as it was attempting to enter Martian orbit. So nothing was generated from that. Now in 2016, I gave a talk to a class of grade 9 students about Mars exploration. The students were working on a project with a scenario that a doomsday asteroid would hit the Earth in several months, and they had to devise a way to send people to Mars to preserve humanity. There was a U of A student who presented what Mars was like, and I presented how we found out. And then I showed them, and part of my presentation, I showed them an upcoming video. And I really felt old, because in my mind, the event in the video wasn't that long ago, but to the students, I realized later, they weren't even born when it happened. So here's the video that I showed them back then. Okay, so that's the video. There were several chuckles when they saw this big ball bouncing across the ground. Now, the same method was used for the Spirit and Opportunity Rovers a few years later. But again, the students were only around two when that was going on. So, whoops, this was the Mars Pathfinder. It was the first craft NASA had sent to Mars in 21 years. It was a test mission to prove the faster, better, cheaper concept could be where a mission could be developed and flown in a fraction of the time at a fraction of the cost of previous missions. In this case, and my cat is scratching at the door. The mission was developed in 3 years, and the Pathfinder lander was developed in $150 million, and the Sojourner rover was $25 million. Viking, which landed in 1976 in a 1996 dollars, was $3.5 billion and took 8 years to reach the launch pad. Also, Viking landed in a flat, safe area using the airbag method. They would attempt to land in a place that had a little bit more interesting terrain. So this is the Pathfinder in its white room prior to launch. You can see how big it is with the people in there for scale. You got the main bus in the center. You've got the three solar panels. You've got the Sojourner rover scrunched up on one of the solar panels. After it landed, it would expand up. And there was, you could see right there, there's little ramps that would roll down, and the Sojourner would roll down once it got to Mars. This is a test of the airbags. You can see how big they are. They inflated with a gas generator on board the craft very, very quickly. Just a matter of a second or two to inflate those airbags. This is a picture landed on Mars with the Sojourner rover. And as you can see, it's scrunched up. You can see the little ramp. There was another one on the other side, but they didn't unroll it because the airbags, which were pulled in by cables underneath the craft, this one didn't quite get out of the way. So they figured, we'll just go out this way, the safe way, and ensure that the rover actually gets down onto the surface so it can roll around. In the background, you can see two mountains which were dubbed the Twin Peaks after the TV show that was quite popular at the time. The Sojourner rover was about the size of a microwave oven, and it carried cameras and an alpha proton X-ray spectrometer called APEX, which was used to analyze the components of rocks and soil. The APEX was a spectrometer that analyzed chemical element composition of samples using scattered alpha particles and a fluorescent X-rays that were irradiated from a device on the front of the rover. And this is a panoramic shot. They didn't use this side of the ramp. They went down on this side. And you can see Sojourner up against a rock here. There's the Twin Peaks. And this is a close-up of Sojourner with the APEX right on the very front. And what it would do, it would drive up to the rock and actually make contact with the rock. And it would sit there for sometimes a few days analyzing the rock with these alpha particles. This rock in particular was nicknamed Yogi because they thought it looked like the head of a bear as seen from behind. And you can kind of see the bear's nose and its ears. So they named it after Yogi Bear. They found most of the rocks were of volcanic origin. And this rock in particular, Yogi, appeared to have been carried into that area by possibly running water sometime long ago in the past of Mars. This is a picture that Sojourner took looking back at Pathfinder. You can see the American flag, the JPL logo. The craft was designed to last anywhere between a month or a week to a month, but it actually lasted until September 27th, landing on July the 4th, when the craft just went silent. They theorized that during the Martian night, something malfunctioned in the cold, and the craft fell silent. The Mars Pathfinder was renamed the Carl Sagan Memorial Station after the famous popularizer of science. Carl Sagan died just a few weeks before the mission launched. The mission launched actually in November of 1996. Now, in Andy Weir's book, The Martian, and later in the movie starring Matt Damon, the stranded astronaut Matt Watney salvages Pathfinder and uses it to communicate with Earth. And there's a shot from the movie. He's dug out Pathfinder from under the sands. And he also took the Sojourner home and used it as kind of an RC toy. And Sojourner was also featured in the opening titles of Star Trek Enterprise. But Pathfinder wasn't the only craft going to Mars 25 years ago. There was also, in the same launch window as Pathfinder, the Mars Global Surveyor was launched on November the 7th, 1996, and arrived at Mars on September 11th, 1997. And there's a drawing of it in orbit. And its mission was to examine the surface features of Mars and determine its composition, physical properties of the rocks and ice, and to map the planet in greater detail than previous missions. And also to determine if Mars had a magnetic field, and if so, how strong was it? If it was a partial field, to make a map of that. Also to monitor global weather and to study the interactions between Mars' atmosphere and the surface, including the polar caps, the dust, and the clouds, and also to map out future landing sites for future missions. The spacecraft lost contact with Earth on November 2nd, 2006. It was actually designed for a two-year mission, but it lasted much longer than that. And it was actually, there wasn't really anything wrong with the spacecraft. It was due to a human error in a software upload that caused the spacecraft to go out of orientation and lose contact with Earth, and eventually lose the solar panels pointing at the sun, and the craft just died. But since July 1997, 25 years ago, there have been spacecraft operating continuously on and or above Mars. So after ignoring the planet for 21 years, humans have had a constant presence on Mars and above Mars. Now, one of the features that scientists for 21 years had been saying is this thing. This is called the Face on Mars. And this was taken by the Viking orbiter back in 76. And people thought, oh my gosh, it's a face. Although why people on Mars would build a face pointing straight up is beyond me. But anyway, And scientist says, no, it's just shadow. It's just like looking at a natural feature and seeing some familiar shape, like the old man of the mountain or Jesus on a piece of cheese toast. It's nothing. It's just light and shadow. Anyway, the Mars Global Surveyor did image that same feature with its much better cameras. And that's actually what it is. It's just a bit of a hill, and you can kind of make out how they made the face. There's one of the arms or one of the eyes, I guess. You know, if the sun was at a low angle, I guess you could see maybe an eye and maybe a mouth here or whatever. But anyway, it's just a hill. It's nothing. There's no face on Mars, but it did cause lots of among the tinfoil hat people. They got all excited, and anyway, less I say about that, the better, I guess. Now humans have gotten pretty good at sending craft to Mars. China, India, and the United Arab Emirates reached Mars on their first try. And there hasn't been a failure since 2011. Now, going back to those students I talked to back in 2016, they were figuring out how to save humanity and get to Mars in a hurry, I pointed out to them that getting to Mars was hard. And based on the numerous failures that had occurred. So in the spirit of the Academy Awards, I put together a short in memoriam video, and I will play it now. Shed a tear for all those craft. Heavensabove.com is a great site. I used charts earlier on for satellite passes, but it's more than just satellites. It's star maps, it's comet finding charts, all sorts of interesting stuff. Always something good on Heavens Above. The next What's Up is going to be on Wednesday, the August 3rd, 7:30. We're taking a break over the summer months, so the next regular meeting of the RASC is not going to be until September the 12th. We haven't decided if we're going to be in person or not, but we are going to record the session and put it on YouTube after. And Alistair's taking a break over the summer also, and so his next introduction to stargazing won't be until Wednesday, September the 28th. And with that, I'll say thank you. And are there any questions? I'll stop the share. Oh, I see a couple chats here. I took a picture of the dumbbell past weekend. Oh, great. And I have to run. Thanks for the presentation. Okay. All right, if there's any questions, you can type them in the chat, or you can just unmute yourself and talk away.
Well, while I have the mic here, there was a a great retrospective on Mars.
Oh, thanks.
I remember it at one point, Ross Sinclair said, and this was years ago, it was like, hang on a sec. The kids born today know we've always been on Mars, but you know, for us, just you know, only half generation before, it's like we're driving on Mars. How cool is that?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the influence of the Pathfinder, particularly that little rover, was a really popular thing. I mean, Hot Wheels even made a little car of that rover. Actually, I've got it on a shelf behind my green screen. I should get it out, but you know, it's only this big, you know, but you know, it's a pretty cool little thing. So
some of those failures, one of the ones was literally somebody did not convert miles to kilometers, and they essentially burned up in the atmosphere instead of being slowed down by the atmosphere.
Yeah, that was the Mars Climate Orbiter.
Yeah.
And the same time, in the same launch window, they launched the Mars Polar Lander. They lost that too, because when the legs sprung open, it shook the spacecraft so much that it thought it landed, and it turned its motors off, and it just came down and crashed. So that was kind of the end of the faster, better, cheaper missions. After that, they went back and spent a little bit more money on development and testing.
But the airbag one also sort of reminds me of, we got a wonderful talk at Devil's World of Science from Steve Squires. I think he was Sojourner and not Pathfinder, but he was the lead scientist. And he was saying, okay, imagine, take your laptop, you know, take it off your desk and drop it. Do you think it's going to still work? And,
yeah.
And it's like, nobody would do that. And that's why we use airbags.
Right.
But you know, you can imagine the pitch to, okay, we're going to, you know, lob it down, but don't worry, the airbags will save it. You just imagine the administrators going, oh my God, these guys are nuts.
Yeah.
But it worked.
It did.
And of course, they had done all the calculations that, yeah, the airbags slow you down so that, you know, landing with airbags is a lot softer than dropping your laptop 1 meter.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and it did leave marks on the surface that Global Surveyor later photographed, you know, the bounce marks.
The bounce.
Mm. Yeah, because it bounced quite a bit and rolled quite a ways after it landed. But then, like I said earlier, you know, it got them into a more interesting area, something they wouldn't have been able to do with Viking, because chances are it would have come down on top of a rock and tipped over or something like that. Mm-hmm. They needed to land in someplace boring.
How many failed spaceships were in that list you had?
How many were there?
Yeah.
I don't know. I have to go back and look. I didn't actually count them. It's quite a few. Yeah. The Russians have had absolutely horrible luck with Mars. They've never really had a successful Mars mission, except for one that's there right now. But they teamed up with the European Space Agency for that. But yeah, they were shooting craft at Mars for a long time, and every one of them failed. Now, interestingly enough, they had a very successful program of going to Venus.
And, which is tougher.
Which is tougher to get to Venus than it is to get to Mars, because it's an inner orbit and that. But they, you know, they were the first people to orbit Venus, the first people to land on Venus and return data from the surface and pictures from the surface. But for Mars, they just had no luck at all. If they didn't have bad luck, they would have no luck at all. So,
yeah, like you said, it was essentially 2011 that where the tip over to success happened. And yeah. before that, it was something like 40% were yeah. failures. And just yeah. like, oh boy.
Yeah, for sure. All right. Is there anything else? Okay. Well, thank you very much for joining us. This has been recorded, and I'll take out a few of the whoopses and put it up on YouTube in a day or two. And you can watch it again if you like. So thanks to Alistair. Thanks to all you guys for joining us here tonight. I'm looking out the window and it looks pretty cloudy. So it looks like we're going to get our rainstorm. So I will say good night and have a pleasant July and happy Canada Day also. Hmm. All right. Good night.
Good night, everyone.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.